And Father, we ask you to help us tonight as we continue to look at the life of this amazing man. Help us to understand what it means to serve God in a culture that is often contrary to what we believe, a culture that's often difficult, sometimes a culture that's it actually persecutes. Help us to know how to serve you and how to find our place. We give thanks to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Had a couple of questions, and I'm going to summarize and kind of synthesize the questions and try to answer them with one answer. Some folks have said, why didn't Daniel, you know, he's in a position of authority, why didn't he undermine Babylon? Why didn't he try to tear Babylon down from the inside? After all, Babylon was the enemy. I understand those questions, and it's a very tough question. I want to say this. Daniel did not work for any evil agenda of Babylon. He took the commands that had come from Jeremiah, where Jeremiah said, go to Babylon, serve the nation. In our vernacular, plant trees. You're going to be there for a couple of generations, and then I'm going to bring you back. Seek God for the good of the city. And Daniel teaches us something about serving a culture in which we live without participating in the evil of that culture. That's why he was frequently in trouble. He would not participate. He wouldn't bow when he was supposed to bow. He wouldn't stop praying when he was supposed to be praying. But he found a way to serve, and we know from last week's lesson that he had a deep and abiding respect and a care for Nebuchadnezzar. And I believe that Daniel's care for Nebuchadnezzar resulted in Nebuchadnezzar making a profession of faith in the true and the living God. So I think what we need to do, we need to understand, and I understand that it's a balancing act, but both we need to teach our children, we need to teach them how to serve the Lord, be above the reproach of the world in whatever culture they're in, but to not act like the world in their opposition to the world. It's a fine line. And what we're going to find out tonight is that Daniel didn't have a view of tolerance of the evil of Babylon. Daniel never said, well, that's just politics. We've got to be politically correct. No, Daniel was frequently in trouble for his stand. But I think the greatest thing we need to understand, especially in the culture of today, and one of the greatest things we can teach our children is how to be in the world but not of the world. How to influence the world with opposite behavior. Remember Jesus said when someone curses you, you're not to out-curse them. You're to bless them. When someone does you wrong, you're not to seek vengeance. You're to do them good. And that's, we call it opposite behavior. It's the principle of opposite behavior. It's tough, but I hope I answered that question adequately for you. Now, by the time we get to chapter 5, Nebuchadnezzar has died. We are remembering Nebuchadnezzar's dream of the image. Nebuchadnezzar was the head of gold. Now we're about to see the torso of silver. The next kingdom is coming, and that is the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians. Now, you'll read some history a few decades before this, and the Medes and Persians were two different empires, but Cyrus the Persian had conquered the Medes, and they were now a nation together, the Medes serving the Persians, but it was called the kingdom of the Medes and Persians, or Medo-Persia, you might read. At the head of all of this is Cyrus, but we'll talk about Cyrus later. You remember from the movie, you remember Cyrus, he was the king that had confronted Daniel out in the wilderness. It's a long passage, so bear with me as we read. King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles and drank wine with them. Now, in just a minute, we'll go over who Belshazzar is and how he came to power. Why, but sufficient to say, he's the king that has replaced Nebuchadnezzar. There's actually two of them, Nabonidus and Belshazzar. That's why when Belshazzar makes his offer to Daniel, he says he'll make him the third ruler in the kingdom. And I just said we'll get to that. I'm already at it, so let's back up. King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles and drank wine with them. While Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in the gold and silver goblets that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem, so that the king and his nobles, his wives and concubines, might drink from them. So they brought in the golden goblets that had been taken from the temple of God in Jerusalem. The king and his nobles, his wives and his concubines drank from them. As they drank the wine, they praised the gods of gold and silver, of bronze, iron, wood, and stone. And suddenly the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the wall near the lampstand in the royal palace. The king watched the hand as it wrote. His face turned pale, and he was so frightened that his legs became weak and his knees were knocking. And that's a good translation of what the original text says. His legs couldn't hold him up, so it was as though his knees were knocking together. Verse 7, the king summoned the enchanters, astrologers, and diviners. Then he said to these wise men of Babylon, whoever reads this writing and tells me what it means will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed around his neck, and he will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom. Then all the king's wise men came in, but they could not read the writing or tell the king what it meant. Now, it's interesting. This was written, this is a very small part of the Old Testament. It's written in Aramaic. Aramaic was commonly known. In fact, it was at least in part of the Babylonian, the time of the Babylonian kingdom. It was the language of the court. There's no reason that these guys couldn't read this. I mean, they knew the language. But this is a good lesson about the prophetic tonight. In English, English is English to us. And everybody might not talk good English like we do, but it's just basically English, you know. And but there was a trick to reading Aramaic. And we're going to find out in a minute why they saw the words but couldn't read them. And I think it's a good lesson for everybody that feels you're prophetic. Things are not always what they appear to be. And I want to give my 2 cents worth right here. Don't be too quick to interpret what you feel the Lord gives you, because what God gives you is often multi-layered. So we'll see that in just a moment. Whoever reads this writing and tells me what it means will be clothed in purple, have a gold chain placed around his neck, and he will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom. Then all the king's wise men came in, but they could not read the writing or tell the king what it meant. So King Belshazzar became even more terrified, and his face grew more pale. His nobles were baffled. The queen, hearing the voices of the king and his nobles, came into the banquet hall. Thank God for good women. May the king live forever, she said. Don't be alarmed. Don't look so pale. There is a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the holy gods in him. In the time of your father, meaning Nebuchadnezzar, he was found to have insight and intelligence and wisdom like that of the gods. Now you've got to understand, by now Daniel is probably in his 70s, maybe even has reached his 80s, maybe. Your father, King Nebuchadnezzar, appointed him chief of the magicians, enchanters, astrologers, and diviners. He did this because Daniel, whom the king called Belteshazzar, was found to have a keen mind and knowledge and understanding, and also the ability to interpret dreams, explain riddles, and solve difficult problems. Call for Daniel, and he will tell you what the writing means. So Daniel was brought before the king, and the king said to him, are you Daniel, one of the exiles my father and king brought from Judah? Well, I find it so hard to believe that this man, having access to such wisdom and experience, obviously has never even met Daniel, or if so, it was only a casual encounter. I've heard that the spirit of the gods is in you and that you have inside intelligence and outstanding wisdom. The wise men and enchanters were brought before me to read this writing and tell me what it means, but they could not explain it. Now I've heard that you are able to give interpretations and to solve difficult problems. If you can read this writing and tell me what it means, you will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed around your neck, and you will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom. Then Daniel answered the king, "You may keep your gifts for yourself and give your rewards to someone else." Daniel wasn't being arrogant. He knew the words of Jeremiah. He knew what was happening. The minute he saw these words, he knew what was happening, and he knew that this kingdom was about to fall. Nevertheless, I will read the writing for the king and tell him what it means. Your Majesty, the Most High God, gave your father Nebuchadnezzar sovereignty and greatness and glory and splendor. Because of the high position he gave him, excuse me, all the nations and peoples of every language dreaded and feared him. Those the king wanted to put to death, he put to death. Those he wanted to spare, he spared. And those he wanted to promote, he promoted. Those he wanted to humble, he humbled. But when his heart became arrogant and hardened with pride, he was deposed from his royal throne and stripped of his glory. Then he tells about what happened last week. To us last week. He was driven away from people and given the mind of an animal. He lived with the wild donkeys and ate grass like the ox, and his body was drenched with the dew of heaven until he acknowledged that the Most High God is sovereign over all kingdoms on earth and sets over them anyone he wishes. But you, Belshazzar, his son, have not humbled yourself, though you knew all this. Instead, you have set yourself up against the Lord of heaven. You had the goblets from his temple brought to you, and to your nobles, your wives, and your concubines drank from them. You praised the gods of silver and gold, of bronze, iron, wood, and stone, which cannot see or hear or understand. But you did not honor the God who holds in his hand your life and all your ways. Therefore, he sent the hand that wrote the inscription. This is the inscription that was written. Mene, Mene, Tekel, Parson. And the original word was Upharsin. And we'll explain what happens in just a moment. Daniel is already giving an interpretation of that last word. Here is what these words mean. Mene, God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Tekel, you have been weighed on the scales and found wanting. Perez, your kingdom, which is the singular form of Upharsin. Perez, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Then at Belshazzar's command, Daniel was clothed in purple. A gold chain was placed around his neck, and he was proclaimed the third highest ruler of the kingdom. But that very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain. And Darius the Mede took over the kingdom at the age of 62. This is a powerful story in the book of Daniel. It has so many lessons that we draw from it. The central truth is a big, obvious thing. And it is that though God is patient, he eventually calls all men and nations to the table of judgment. I want you to understand, and I hope I made this clear when I tried to answer the questions at the beginning of the lesson tonight. When Daniel speaks with spiritual integrity and honesty. Daniel never changed his story depending on whom he was speaking to. He never compromised his life from chapter 1 all the way through here to chapter 5. There's never an incident. In fact, through the whole book, there's never an incident of Daniel letting that culture shape him and mold him. You see, you say, Pastor, why are you so insistent about this? I don't want to be misunderstood, and I realize that we are a culture, even in the church, so divided that I can be easily misunderstood. But the Holy Word in our society today is tolerance. And that spread over into church. In the average church in America, we're not called to be light and darkness. We're not called to be truth and lies. We're called to be nice. We're called to be tolerant. And the word tolerant, now again, I think you understand there's a sense in which we need to be tolerant. You should never, if a Muslim moves in next door to you, you should never be intolerant of that Muslim. You should never start a petition to drive the Muslims out. You should be the best neighbor you can possibly be. And I don't think we need to, I think we're misunderstood and we're misdirected when we start signing petitions. We don't want that mosque built in our neighborhood. They have a right to build a mosque in our neighborhood, just like we have a right to build a church in a neighborhood. That's the nature of America. Now, that doesn't mean we need to embrace the theology of Islam. And it doesn't mean we need to have a fellowship dinner and say, well, we're all going to the same place. But we need to understand that we need to act and be tolerant Americans, tolerant of other beliefs, tolerant of everyone, but we need to understand we don't allow that tolerance to change our foundational beliefs. We don't allow that tolerance to change our behavior. I was speaking to a person of another religion in the restaurant, and we've become friends, and we talk back and forth. And he said not too long ago, he said, you can't tell me that I'm not going to heaven because I don't believe in Jesus. And I looked at him and smiled and said, I can and I am. And he kind of laughed and I kind of laughed. And he said, you're serious. I said, I'm very serious. He said, I thought you were a good American, tolerant of me. I said, I am. I said, I have breakfast with you. I love you. I call you my friend. But your theology is wrong. And without Jesus, none of us have a chance. And he kind of got upset. And to his credit, I got to say this, just in case he came in and I don't see him in the back. to his credit, he apologized the next morning. And he said, you were being very Christian in what you said, and I apologize for being angry. But we're in a culture that if you disagree with anything, you're a hater, you're a racist, you're intolerant, and you need to be locked up somewhere. And Daniel never caved in to that kind of thing. When you listen to what he said to the king, it was very clear. This is what I believe. This is what you are. This is what you've done. And now it's time to pay the piper. God has come to judge you. Now, that's why I want to say, again, I know I say this about once a month, but the Lord put on my heart months ago, I don't even remember when I first said it now, but the Lord told me that the way I was to pray and that I was to share it with you, and I think Justin has done it a time or two as well. Number one, the Lord told me in regard to our nation that there's an urgent set of prayer requests, and it doesn't go along party lines. He told me that we need to pray that lies and liars will be exposed. All lies and all liars. And number two, he told me that we need to pray that truth in all its forms will arise. Number three, he told me that we need to pray that the church will wake up and be what the church was meant to be. And the fourth thing is he said we need to pray that Americans, when confronted with the truth, will know what they ought to do. Because just because a lie is exposed and a truth rises up, that doesn't mean people are going to respond well. I was making a case to a lady one time to tell her that, you know, God is not telling you to marry this man. You have a husband already. And I was showing her some verses, and she took the Bible out of my hand and threw it on the floor and said, I don't care what the Bible says. All I know is what the Spirit told me. And I learned right then. I mean, I was just a teenager in Bible college, but I learned right then that you can be confronted with truth. You can have a lie exposed, But the jury is still out on whether you're going to do what's right, even when you know the truth. I don't know. Let me just say it this way. I really have felt challenged by the Lord to stop saying, you know, it doesn't matter what your political views are. I've said that for years. But loved ones, can I tell you, I'm not even comfortable saying that anymore. I think we've bought into this idea of these are my politics and this is my Christianity, and we embrace things that no child of God should ever embrace. And I'm through saying your politics don't matter. I'm saying your politics matter a lot. You say, well, I don't like any party. What do? I don't know. I don't know, and I'm not trying to skirt the issue. I don't know, but we need to pray and we need to get the mind of God, because we can no longer separate things like our politics and our ethics and our morals and our view of life. We can no longer separate that from our Christianity and say, yeah, I love Jesus, and this is just my politics. You can't do that. You can't do it anymore. Daniel makes that clear to us. Now, let's set the stage. My word, I'm amazing. Setting the stage. We know that Daniel was clearly a student of the prophet Jeremiah. I'm sorry, guys. Excuse me. You remember we've been talking about Jeremiah, Daniel, and Ezekiel are contemporaries. They're all alive at the same time. Daniel is taken out of Babylon with the first siege of the city. Ezekiel goes with the second siege of the city about 12 or 14 years later. And Jeremiah is left in Jerusalem. And he's left in Jerusalem till Jerusalem is conquered, finally. Three times Nebuchadnezzar goes against Jerusalem trying to get them to conform. The first time, it was just, we're going to take the best of your young men. And that's when Daniel went. That was about 606. And about 592, he takes another group of men, and Ezekiel goes. And then in 586, the whole thing comes tumbling down. But Jeremiah was sending prophetic messages not only to the people of Jerusalem and Judah, but also to the exiles that were in Babylon. Ezekiel was in Babylon. He's sending messages back to Jerusalem. So God is stirring these prophets, and they're going back and forth. And this is what Jeremiah said. First of all, Daniel knew they were going to be in Babylonian captivity, Jeremiah 25. They're going to be there for 70 years. Now, God actually starts bringing them back before the 70 years is up. But by the time everything, the return is in full motion, 70 years have passed. And this is what he learns from what we have. Daniel didn't have, they didn't have chapter divisions back then. That was the result of a very wise Catholic monk back, I think it was around the 1100s, I think, if memory serves. He said, boy, it would be easier for folks to find scriptures if we gave it an address. So he divided it into chapters and verses, and we're thankful for that. You say, well, I don't think you ought to mess with the Word of God. Well, one of the writers in the New Testament, I love what he said. He said, somewhere it says, and he quotes the Old Testament. I'm glad I can talk about Jeremiah 25 than saying somewhere Jeremiah says. So we knew they were going to be there about 70 years. Daniel knows that it's coming close for the time of this exile to end. He also knows from chapters 50 and 51, this is what Jeremiah prophesied, Babylon would be attacked from the north by the king of the Medes. Okay? Babylon would be well provisioned. Psalm 51:26. Jeremiah prophesied to the people and said, they're not going to come against you because they need what you've got. In chapter 51, verses 53 and 58, he said the inhabitants of Babylon would trust their walls and towers and gates. That's exactly what happened. But the city would be captured by a clever strategy. That's what caught in a snare means, and I don't know why I didn't put that verse down. He said, Jeremiah did, that God would dry up her fountain or allow capture through a manipulation of the water supply. Now, we know from history that the Medes blocked the flow of the Euphrates River and diverted it, and they were able to enter the city through basically what we would call a dried riverbed, where they went under the walls. We know that lack of preparation due to the drunkenness of her people would lead to the fall of Babylon. And boy, this is a bad, bad party going on. And Jeremiah said that's how it's going to happen. And the capture of Babylon was also prophesied by Isaiah, who actually names Cyrus as the conquering king nearly 200 years earlier. I was in a class with someone, and he said, we know that the book of Isaiah was written about 200 to 250 years later than some people say. And it was a discussion. I said, how do you know that? Why would it make you say we know that? He said, because he named Cyrus. He couldn't have known Cyrus's name if Cyrus hadn't been a politically active figure. I said, God told Isaiah. He said, that works if you believe that God actually talks to people, you know. Well, we believe God actually talks to people. And he spoke to Isaiah that Cyrus was coming. I wish I'd written this better. Isaiah 13 and 21 are the chapters that talk about this event. But let me give you the verses where Cyrus is mentioned by name. It's Isaiah 44, 28. Isaiah 44, 28. I think it's 28. Justin, can you check that for me? Isaiah 44, 28. I know 44 is right. And Isaiah 45, 1. Isaiah 45, 1 and Isaiah 44, I think it's 28. We'll get the verdict in just a moment on that. Now, let's go to Roman numeral 2. That is right. Okay, 44, 28. Okay. Let's go to Roman numeral 2, which we call an appeal to the gods of Babylon. This was Belshazzar's, I call it his attempt at faith in the sight of the pagan deities. He had three bad ideas. Number one, he gathered the village gods from the outlying areas. We know from historical documents that he went to all the villages around Babylon, brought in their gods for this celebration, and he ordered a festival of worship to these gods. And it's almost like, we can't tell if this was his big revealing, you know, we're going to drink from the cups that were from the temple of Jehovah, or if it was like, boy, we need to up the ante a little bit, and he sent for them. But either way, it was a bad idea, because it was an attempt to insult Yahweh by drinking from the vessels captured in the temple of Jerusalem. It appears either way that this was an attempt to distance himself from Nebuchadnezzar's acceptance and exaltation of the Almighty God of the Jews. Now, let me give you just a little bit of historical background. I know not everybody likes this. It might be boring to you. But you got to understand, other than the book of Genesis, there's no book of the Bible more attacked, more questioned, more viciously attacked by liberal theologians than the book of Daniel. They find all kinds of problems with the book of Daniel. For instance, most theological books from the 1800s say that there was never a time that Babylon had two leaders. There's no evidence that there was ever. So Daniel is wrong about this being two leaders. Daniel being made the third ruler, that implies there are two. He said that's just ludicrous. And in about 1870, they uncovered some inscriptions from this period of Babylonian history that talked about Belshazzar and Nabonidus. And then since then, they found other things about Nabonidus. And what we can tell, piecing history together, Belshazzar, this is letter B under Roman numeral 2 if you're lost in your notes. Belshazzar was the son or stepson of Nabonidus. Nabonidus was the son or son-in-law of Nebuchadnezzar. Okay, so you've got Nebuchadnezzar and his son or son-in-law. You know, Nabonidus was either his son or married the daughter of Nebuchadnezzar. And Nabonidus had participated in an overthrow of one or two kings who ruled briefly after the death of Nebuchadnezzar. In other words, when Nebuchadnezzar died, there was a struggle for power. A couple of guys ascended to the throne, but they didn't last long. Nabonidus says, "It's mine because this is my father or my father-in-law," and he had them executed. And so he becomes the king. Now, what we found out in about 1870 is that Nabonidus made Belshazzar the second ruler of the kingdom when he went to Arabia. Now, some people say that he went on a business venture. Most of the evidence says he was off on a hunting expedition in Arabia. But it appears that he returned to Babylon only to leave the city on October 10th, the day before it fell. He was captured and died in exile, Nabonidus. So what you've got is, for the first time in Babylonian history, you've got two rulers, and that's why Daniel is offered the third position of power in the kingdom. Nabonidus, the son or son-in-law of Nebuchadnezzar, appoints Belshazzar, who was his son or stepson. The reading is difficult for us to tell in the historical things that we found. I do want to say this. Let me go ahead and say this now. You say, but Pastor, the text says that Nebuchadnezzar was his father. Now you're saying that he was at best his grandfather and maybe, you know, an in-law kind of thing. I want you to understand, and I think it's in the notes somewhere, in Hebrew there's no word for grandfather or great-grandfather. Little Jackson calls his daddy, Daddy. But he would, if we were in a Hebrew culture, I would be his father. And my father would be his father. And my father's father would be his father. And usually there was a term of endearment used for the physical father, like Abba, you know, a daddy. So they would refer to my daddy, he's my father, but my daddy means he sired me. But my daddy's daddy is my father. And my daddy's daddy is also my father. So that's why when you read passages from in ancient texts like this, it can be a little bit confusing because you can read some stuff and a guy will call three guys his father. Well, what he's doing is he means he's one of my grandfathers. I'm in his lineage. That's why when you read the genealogies, I can tell I'm getting in too deep for you. I'm sorry. Let me wrap it up with this. That's why when you read some of the genealogies in the New Testament, Jesus, when he gave his genealogy, it's 14 generations. That doesn't mean that you go back, 42 generations and that was the beginning of the world. All a Jew had to do was be able to memorize sets of 14 generations. He didn't have to remember all of his ancestors, but he had to have 14 generations connected. Then he went back and took another 14 names. So he may talk about 42 generations, but might have had 79 generations. It's just a way of establishing your identity. Okay, let's go on. You shouldn't have got me off on that. I don't know what you're thinking. But we see that the hand of God or God's allowed the hand to begin to write on the wall. We see the king's collapse at this supernatural event. And Ambassador Daniel is brought in. Daniel disregards the offer to be made the third ruler of Babylon. And he reminds Belshazzar of his grandfather's humbling and repentance. Yeah, that's where I mentioned that about father. So instead of repenting, boy, it's amazing how we'll try to do anything short of true repentance. We'll make deals, we'll make offerings. But Belshazzar says, okay, well then I need to reward you, Daniel. And Daniel's appeal is, you don't need to reward me, you need to repent. But Daniel knew that the repentance was not coming. The king would be dead in an hour. Now, Daniel interprets the handwriting on the wall. Now, I don't want to, again, this is fascinating to me. I don't want to bore you. If you're not interested in this kind of thing, just go ahead and drink your coffee, and I'll call you when I'm through with it in just a moment. But the words, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin, appear on the wall. And the mystery is why did he need somebody to read it and explain it to him? Well, I don't think it's that they could not read it. But let me tell you something about Hebraic languages, and including Aramaic. You read it from right to left, not left to right, like we are. Now, not only do you read it from right to left, but they leave the vowels out, and there are no spaces to indicate that vowels need to be put there. So what that means is that if you don't understand the context, you might really come up with some erroneous interpretations. See, look at letter A up there. You see, starting at the right, you see Mene, and then Mene written backwards to us from right to left, Tekel, right to left, and Perez. Right to left, or which was drawn from Upharsin. But go to letter B. This is what it would have looked like, but there would not have been spaces there. You would have in English, MN, MN. Now the context, they know vowels go there because MN is not a word. Okay, and I'm talking about from an English perspective. But you have to understand the context to know the vowels. Sometimes it's a process of elimination. Sometimes, what I mean by context, if the sentence says there's a lot of water in the BY, context tells you that's bay and not boy, okay? But if the sentence said, I'd love to give a hug to that BY, you don't want to hug the bay, you want to hug the boy. Okay, so context was everything. So number one, they didn't know the context. They didn't know the vowels to put in there. And you got to understand, it was far easier for them than you think it might be. To them, adding the vowels wasn't much more than dotting an I or crossing a T. It was just something that was natural. And when it was translated, for our benefit, we put it the other way, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin, or Perez, what the words meant. See, then they understood the words, but they still didn't understand what the words meant. And that's what I wanted to say to those of you that are prophetic. Just because you get a message from God, don't be too quick to attach an application to that, because you can devastate a church. You can devastate leadership. You can devastate a prayer group or a congregation by saying, oh, I know what this means, when you haven't even prayed about it. And here's what the words translated meant. Numbered. Numbered. Weighed. And divided. And it's interesting. I was reading a rabbi's writing about this. And he said that the vowels that Daniel used for the word tekel, where it means weighed, you could use one of two vowels that would have meant the same thing. He chose the vowel that meant it's weighed and found light. Another vowel would mean it's weighed and found heavy, but this vowel was it's weighed and found light and then divided. So now they're seeing the king's knees are still knocking, and he says, well, here's the message, numbered, numbered, weighed, and divided. And Daniel begins to explain. He says, your administration has been evaluated by God. It's been weighed, and there's nothing that speaks credit to you. It's dishonored, and you're going to be divided. And it's interesting, he goes from Upharsin to Perez by using an alternate vowel, and it almost spells out the word Persian. It almost spells out the word Persian. And Daniel says, you are going to be judged. The kingdom's going to be divided, taken from you, and it's going to Persia, the Medes and the Persians. So Daniel's promoted to the third ruler of the empire. Only Nabonidus and Belshazzar stand between him and the throne. But Daniel knows the kingdom is ending very, very quickly. That night, which was the night of October 11th to 12th on our calendar, in 539 BC, the kingdom fell, and Darius the Mede, who was probably a viceroy or an under-ruler under Cyrus, took control. In fact, we know from history that Cyrus enters 18 days later on October 29th, and eventually Cyrus himself will come there to rule, but he was on another military campaign, and so you have this changing of the guard. Now, next week we'll talk about Daniel in the lion's den. But what I want to just leave you with tonight, I'm trying to follow my heart here. I want you to understand that the judgment and evaluation of society by God is a very real thing. It's a very real thing. And I want to say this, and I've asked the Lord to help me know how to say it the right way, because I don't think I have all truth, you know. And I don't think I have perfect understanding on everything. But I'm really concerned about this. I am fearful for those who call themselves prophets, who prophesy nothing but blessing and good and everything's going to be fine. That's a scriptural position for me to take. I mean, I know that we need to prophesy good when God gives us good to prophesy. And I know we need to prophesy blessing and restoration and miraculous deliverance when God gives us those messages to prophesy. But I want to remind you, the reason Jeremiah went to prison several times and was tortured more than once is because the prophets of Jerusalem said God would never let his temple be touched, and God would never let his temple be destroyed, and God would never let Jerusalem be inhabited. They had forgotten it had already happened twice. And a far worse picture was coming. And guys, don't misunderstand me. I don't think we need to be doom and gloom. I think it's just as bad for somebody to not believe there's hope. I mean, to just everything's bad, you know. And they're the kind of people that say, well, what you did was good, but it ain't good enough, you know. Or what you did was righteous, but you should have been more righteous. Man, we don't need any of that. But we do need to understand that judgment is a very serious thing. And we need to understand that God knows exactly what's going on in our culture. God knows exactly what's going on in our politics. God knows exactly what's going on behind the scene. And I'm telling you, the church needs to wake up and become what she was for almost 200 years, and that is the conscience of the nation. The church has never been commissioned to rule the nation, but the church has been commissioned to be the conscience of the nation. And it was that way from long before we became a nation until probably early in the 20th century, late in the 19th century. The church was a conscience. Monday papers carried, I mean, almost without exception, the Monday newspapers for well over 100 years carried summaries of sermons that were preached Sunday in the churches with warnings and with cautions and with calls to repentance. The church didn't rule things, but the church was the conscience. And when we say we want lies and liars to be exposed, only God can do that. When we say we want truth to be rising up, only God knows what the truth is. Guys, I can't tell you how many times I've figured something out, only to find out I'm wrong. I'd rather not talk about that, and I can't believe you brought it up, but only God knows what's really true and what's really a lie. Only God knows that. And the church needs to rise up to begin to hear the voice of her. The bride needs to hear the voice of her husband again. The church needs to hear the bride needs to hear the voice of her husband again. But right now, we're speaking every other voice. Again, not us. But I'm talking about the church in America. I told you the other day about a man who woke up and his wife was in distress. She was having a bad dream, and he held her and kind of shook her and woke her up. And she opened her eyes. She was still terrified, and it took a few seconds for her to realize that the dream was not real and her husband had her. And this man's testimony was the Lord spoke to him and said, the day is coming that the church will continue to be terrified until she recognizes her husband again. And we have let everything except the Lord be our husband. So he's going to work on that. And we need to pray, because Belshazzar, he found out the truth. He saw the lie. He heard the church. Daniel spoke. But the question is, what will our culture do with the truth? It's not enough to hear. We have to hear and obey. Justin is going to come and lead us in prayer tonight with our prayer focus. And he's been doing such a good job on those. I was praying this over this Monday, and I thought, boy, we need this kind of emphasis, and we need this kind of focus on our prayers. But I do want to say this. If you're here tonight, Jesus is not your Lord and Savior. While we pray, I want to tell you, you don't have to march down an aisle, although that's certainly a good thing to do. And I would encourage you to see me or Justin or somebody that you know is a Christian after the service is dismissed in a few moments. But right where you are, you're able to open your heart to Him and say, Lord Jesus, I know that You're a great God. I know that I have sinned and come short of the glory of God, because all of us have. Isaiah said, all we like sheep have gone astray, and the Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all. I know that I'm a sinner, but I know that You're the Savior. And tonight, Lord, I give my heart to You. I give my sin to You. I give my future to You, my past to You, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I give to You, and I ask You to forgive my sins and come into my heart. You can pray that right now or at any point during our prayer. And I would encourage you, if you do that, to let us know so we can give you some material that will help you in your Christian walk. Okay? God bless.